Hello and welcome to yet another day of the eYantra Robotics Competition 2020-21.
eYantra teaches practical robotics and engineering skills through its competition themes. This year's themes were drawn from the domain of Industry 4.0 problems. Since COVID lockdown made it difficult to distribute hardware, eYantra made COVID-friendly themes through its use of open-source simulation technology.
We have a theme called Sankat Mochan Bot, where students have to program, the teams have to program an FPGA. This is the first time we are doing a theme of this kind of complexity. They have to program an FPGA to solve a problem. So this is the only theme in the competition where we actually had real hardware. 215 teams, which are almost 1,000 students, have been taught how to program FPGAs using Verilog and do some cool stuff in it. But because of the difficulty of this theme, we put a lot of kids into Sankat and only about 4 have come to the finals today.
We outlined the problem along with an objective formula for grading a finished solution. Students were taught all the skills required through project-based learning in competition mode over a period of 6 months. Teams uploaded a video of their final run along with an account of their experiences in reaching the goal. At the finals, the students faced a viva by an IIT Bombay faculty jury.
So I'd like to introduce our jury today.
We now highlight the stages of the competition and detail the skills learned at each stage.
Team comprises the following components. The bot. The brain of the bot is powered by the DE0 nano board that controls sensors and actuators to perform quick safety surveys. It uses wired and wireless communication using Zigbee to transmit messages to a PC, and the bot has a variety of sensors including line following and color sensors to detect what we call faults and to effect actions indicated by the colors on the arena. The bot has RGB LEDs to indicate faults and their remedy. There are a number of challenges. The first is color detection. Faults are indicated through different colors in distinct units. Bridge traversal. Traversing the bridge saves time and helps resolve the fault quickly. Wireless communication. Faults are communicated to the control unit via wireless communication to the laptop. Path planning. Navigating the arena efficiently to find faults and resolving them. Parallel processing. We have concurrent processes for detection of color, navigation, and UART communication.
We followed a principle where one would come up with an idea or an algorithm and the other would critique it, trying to find loopholes and corner cases. This ensured that errors and corner cases would never go unnoticed.
You have to be careful in general when you communicate between different clock domains because you have a potential problem of metastability. It's unlikely in your system because you're not running for very long, probabilistic thing. But if you have your system in the field for a while, let's say for a day or two, and you will start seeing potential errors in the... So there are errors which pop up not in a short time. You have to be in the field for a little bit longer. So one of the things you have to be careful about is, you know, whatever you design has to be robust so that it will last for a long time. What I would suggest for your next project is, you know, you first have a sort of model for your hardware before you start designing it. And essentially look at these technical issues such as, you know, having multiple clock domains, communicating between clock domains. So that's from the correctness point of view. The other aspect is, you know, utilization. How much are you utilizing the hardware that you have up there? Let us say you're using 50,000 logic gates. Are they being used all the time, continuously, or not? That is a question of efficiency. Suppose you spent 1 hour in coding. How many hours did you spend in debugging and verifying? What was the ratio, you know, according to you?
So the ratio would be, I think, close to 1:2. If you spent 1 hour in coding, it would take twice the amount of time to debug it and get it to a perfect stage.
Well, twice is pretty good. For me, it takes me 10 times. If I spend 1 hour in building something, it takes me 10 hours to figure out, to make it work, basically. When you design a controller, let us say, the thing has a controller also, right?
Yes, sir.
You have a controller and you have sensors and you have actuators. Essentially, there are these three things that you have, right? So what is the architecture which holds these? What is the sort of systematic view of this? What holds this structure together? Did you think about it upfront, or it just grew as you went along?
You need to think a bit more architecturally and think in terms of block diagrams and what is happening where in the system, and think more in a model-based way.
your robot was pretty brightly in the sense it was moving at a good clip, and you seem to have a strategy where, you know, it would try to do a sort of I don't know if it was intentional or unintentional, but when it was following the line, it was sort of oscillating around the line, right? So was that by design, or was that why do you think that happened?
So that was not intentional in the beginning. So when I started working on it and I noticed this happening, so when I actually had to implement my path planning algorithm, this was actually beneficial because it helped me, you know, to find out if there's actually a left turn here or a right turn here. And it helped me that way. And it also helped me to adjust trajectory also, and it could go faster on the turns. So then I made it into an intentional thing, kind of, and I improved it.
Before working on this theme, we had no prior experiences of working with FPGAs and Verilog programming. But working on this theme has allowed us to develop these skills and call them our own. It also allowed us to see concepts such as ADC and UART, which we used to study as a theoretical part of our subjects.
How fast a clock did you need really for this design? Like the most computationally intensive part of it, you might not need a very fast clock, right? For the other parts like ADC and accelerometer, what did you need for this path planning?
So the default clock, which was provided 50 megahertz.
Did you divide it down for maybe power optimization? Because you don't need to run it that fast, right? You could sort of gate it, you could reduce the power requirement by running it at the needed speed, right? Did you think about that?
Actually, sir, we didn't thought of that, but we can now do it.
Those of them who are interested in pursuing this concept further, concept of digital design, and of course, you know, the even larger world of embedded systems and mixed hardware software co-design, I think the importance is here that of predictability, in the sense that you need to find a way to get to the solution in a more organized manner, instead of just trying out things until they work. Of course, that's easier said than done. Even if you are trying to build something which you have put in all the theory you can, you finally put things together, there are going to be lots and lots of issues, and maintaining a psychological state of mind to sort of make sure that you don't panic and lose it. That's very important. And I believe this entire group, those four groups that I've seen, they have faced this hurdle and they have surmounted it. So I think what they should be looking for now is to sort of get their theoretical basis a little bit stronger and continue designing systems. And I'm sure they can make a big impact in the long term.
The board given and Yantra has restricted to, they said that you can use only Verilog. But I will ask you to, out of curiosity, you should try MOST. If you are comfortable with other languages, you should make request, and you should try with different ways if you are comfortable with. So time is always welcome. Yeah, that is the thing that I would like to, because just a Verilog, apart from that, you can try with HLS and other languages also.
There are a lot of hard problems to solve in computer science. Look around you and you'll see them staring at you. So one thing I want you to recognize is that these problems are there for us to solve. You don't have to wait for some foreign university or somebody who has no connection with social aspects of India to come and solve the problem, right? So before you go to sleep every night, have a small notebook next to your bed and write in that a few sentences about one of these problems. The chances are that if it's a hard problem, I hope it is, because then we'll do a PhD for you, I think you can solve it only with the help of people from other disciplines. So don't feel shy to collaborate with them and make the solution happen over a period of time. Don't be impatient to solve the problem in no time, because then it won't be a good solution. It may not stand the test of time. So this is something I want to take away as a piece of advice for the future. Don't be assuming that the problem will be visible to you on day one. So what I mean by that is, typically you look at the world around you. For example, let's say you're sleeping and there is really warm, so you want to turn the AC on. You set it at reasonable temperature, then go to sleep. At 2 o'clock, you're woken up by the environment being very cold. What do? You get up, turn on the AC, reduce the temperature, or set the temperature better so that you feel more comfortable than you are now. So now, can you solve this problem automatically? You can, right? Because you know what your reasonable temperature is for you, or for the person in the same room, and then you can set the temperature accordingly. Now, if you have to get up and do it, then you probably lost your sleep for half an hour, and then you curse yourself, and the next day you say, I would rather sleep in the cold environment than wake up and lose the sleep. So how do you solve the, how do you address this problem of adjusting the temperature? First of all, you have to know what temperature you have to set, and then how to set the temperature such that that temperature that's achieved in the room and what you have being given by the air conditioners in the room have the right match and all that. But as you have a set of solutions or set of problems to munch on later, you will start to slowly see how problems are defined. Okay, by that I mean, where does it work? Who's going to pay for it? How much does it cost? How does it get repaired? How do you provide an ecosystem to repair it? If you had a solution which is more general purpose than you have developed a solution for, you'll notice it, and that will lead you to bigger things than what you started with. So be aware of that possibility, and also be aware of the fact that what you have might be larger than what you think, than what you have planned for. The problem that you're solving might itself require some existing solutions to work as a problem.
What Amitabh Bachchan had said in Padman film, don't see us as 1.3 billion mouths to feed, see us as 1.3 billion minds who can engage in avishkar, in invention. I think this is really cool what you've said, Kriti. You said that we should be looking for problems, we should be looking for solutions, we should try and generalize the solutions that we find, and then in the process of generalizing, see what is there around us as building blocks to use. You don't have to reinvent the wheel from scratch. Try and digest a problem down into sub problems, right? Don't try and be too much of a rock star and just say, I'll just solve the difficult things. You need to digest it down. As you said, necessity is the mother of invention. And most importantly, you said, be aware. Now, this is something I'm very conscious of on a daily basis. I sleep thinking about problems that Iyantra has to solve all the time. And he's also saying that something very important, you know, that an entrepreneur is embedded inside the opportunity. The entrepreneur could be a PhD student, it could be a master's student, it could be a student who wants to do a BTech project, just wants to solve a problem. And that person is embedded in the opportunity. So what's beautiful is that India is full of problems to solve because it's a very fast growing economy. You cannot just take things from abroad and marry them here because their problems are different. We are trying to be that platform which enables many, many young people to feel empowered enough to solve those problems. Most importantly, he says, don't let yourself down by subpar, suboptimal jobs. Be aware of your potential. Your potential is much, much more. And we've discovered that in Iyantra again and again and again every year of our almost decade of existence, that you guys can do a hell of a lot. So that is the story of a theme in the Iyantra Robotics Competition, EYRC 2020-21, featuring Industry 4.0 themes. We try to fit the highlights of 4 intense hours of finals interaction into a 20-minute video to give you a taste of what goes on in learning with the Iyantra. We particularly thank our jury members for sharing with us their valuable insights into the thought processes that make for great engineering. It's truly an engineering masterclass. So till next year's competition, God bless and Jai Hind.